look at two terms, legality and legitimacy, and I make a proposal for a call to integrity beyond legitimacy and legality, and I conclude. This higher doctorate is actually a labor of love for me because it's a journey from my initial attraction to law around about 1979 and through the twin paths of teaching and research. And I became uneasy with law along the path. Warwick actually, and it's sad that Professor Yashpal Gai is not here, it was Warwick that really pricked my unease with law. When I studied law in and development and learned that law operates within a context, be it social, economic or political. I was later to go to the University of Zimbabwe. And actually the University of Zimbabwe remains my intellectual mecca because it is a place where I was able again to engage with feminist critiques of law and to own my identity as a woman with audacity to challenge law's claims of finality, objectivity, and clarity. And this would only be increased as I studied other areas when I went to Stanford and studied environmental law, property law, and law, science, and technology. Inter, multi, and transdisciplinary research untethered and freed me from the shackles of law. The dalliance that I had with non-legal issues flavored and brought life to law for me. International economic development was very exciting, sustainable development, technology, women's studies, trade knowledge, etc. And my hands were no longer tied in law speak. I would not be able to say this statement that I'm a lawyer. To save time, let's just assume I'm never wrong because I learned that there are other things outside of law. So the statement, law is, did not mute me, and I asked why. And I've had ample room and time in the academy to critique and interrogate law, legal norms, actors, structures, and institutions. And you know, one of the biggest questions I asked was, what was the essence of my undergraduate study in law? And I'm not being critical of those who taught me in undergraduate law. But with the benefit of more thought and reading, I realized that the law I had learned was sanitized, it was bland, and it was abstracted from my lived realities. Nothing I was taught related to my multiple identities as a woman, as a mother, as a daughter, as a sister. And the closest it came to relate to my identity, and those who were in school with me in those years remember, the late George Rukwaro's statement that a law essay ought to be the length of a lady's skirt. Long enough to cover the subject matter, but short enough to sustain the interest. Or Justice Aaron Ringera's statement that his evidence exams was the way he turned men into boys. As for the ladies, he wanted them just the way they were. Now, I would say those were sexist statements, but at that point, I bet I laughed at the humor. I was also not taught about my identity as a member of an ethnic community. So I was taught law as if law applied to everybody anyhow, or even as a person who professed a particular faith. So I encountered a fourfold identity crisis. What is law? What is my role as a lawyer in society, and how do I navigate law space within the realities that I'm in? What is my role as a woman in and of the law? And answers were hard to come by. So I embarked on a journey of exploration of the space between my becoming a lawyer, my being a lawyer, and ultimately my becoming a woman of law. and locating myself in the variety of normative subjectivities by being a woman and all the identities that come with being a woman, my being a member of an ethnic community, my being a member of, my professing a particular faith, my socioeconomic and political class, my clan, my family, and you know, family is brought here because there's the nuclear, the NATO, and my in-law family, my domicile of choice. And all these had implications for my identities. And I discovered that critique of law comes with the territory of studying law. It is quintessential to the study of law and requires rigor and reflection. So what's my argument? My argument is that formal law's claims of clarity, coherence, objectivity, certainty, stability are misleading. Because where law is defined to include other norms, custom, religion, and practices, its context and interpretation is flavored by those norms. Formal law does not control all people's lives and affairs in legal systems with diverse norms, especially in post-colonial societies. Formal law and other norms that operate with it may actually pull in different directions, and the overriding norms aren't always the formal ones. And in my observation, formal law, custom, religion, and practices as law, which are recognized in our constitution, are strange bedfellows, because there is no calculus which determines what really prevails in the event of conflict. And we therefore have these multiple contestations and tensions between formal law and other norms. And these contestations are compounded by four interrelated issues. One, the non-formal norms may be and actually often are more compelling and accessible. People can be active also in spaces where formal law norms have not yet arrived, and the arrival of formal law is not always welcome, as we will see. Lawlessness or informalism can also become a standard operating procedure that challenges the operation of formal law norms. And here, the example of political coalitions and handshakes that we have in this country after divisive elections, which may actually displace constitutional norms and could even catalyze constitutional change, as we are now discussing in this country. We can also have rampant corruption, bad driving, matatuism, and border-borderism, which breed a culture of impunity where formal law is wantonly violated with no consequences. And so we have a new normal. We don't actually see bad driving as problematic. So we also have actions that abound that are neither legal nor illegal. They are outside the framework of law, and for instance, scientific experimentation and technological innovation, which are actually inquiry-driven with curiosity at the core. To earth my discussion, this is probably the toughest part of my discussion, I used some key concepts. I couldn't find any theories that really covered the work I was doing. And so what I did was to look at a number of concepts which I thought related to my work: the nature of law, the force of law, origins of law, legal pluralism, and the related hierarchies of the normative orders, power, the public and the private, and coloniality. What is law? What is law is actually a very long jurisprudential debate that is yet to be resolved. So while we are agreed that law is an indispensable tool, its meaning is elusive and indeterminate. And according to Cher, people steer their lives through an obstacle of rules. So even as we sit here, all of us, all dressed very nicely, you are all extremely smart, we are an amalgam of contending norms. So maybe your tribal law calls on you to be this way, the formal law calls on you to be this way, and then you also you subscribe to a faith which also has requirements on you. And these rules many times tell us stop, move, don't do it this way. And you can see that choosing the right way can be very difficult when you have no entry. There's two ways to go. And there could be norms, rules, some are called juridical norms, some are taboos. And the question is, are they all law? And my proposition is that I have not seen any touch and feel definition of law. Because when you ask people what law is, they begin to explain. Rather than tell you law is, they explain its origins, it's from God, from the people, from the sovereign, what are its functions, its consequences, or they'll give you examples. Some people will even tell you law is what courts say is law. But what about those norms, both formal and informal, that never darken the door of a court? Others link law to the consequences of breach. But you know that there may be people who are more afraid of the supernatural or losing faith than going to jail or being fined. And actually, there is no telling what proverbial sword of Damocles threatens a person more, whether it's jail, fine, shame, curse. And the question one asks is, are lawyers the best place to tell which sword is the biggest threat? Then the nature of law. Formal law exists alongside other norms that regulate human conduct, and I think I've talked about this, religion, etiquette, but they are the semi-autonomous social fields defined by Sally Fockmore, the legal anthropologist, to be norm-generating and norm-enforcing realm. And the question is, where does formal law derive its validity and legitimacy from, and where do these other norms derive their validity from? And we have explanations by classical natural law authors who say that law emanates from God, is consistent with God's law, and therefore there can be no unjust laws. But there are others like Cicero who will say law is right reason in agreement with nature. Then, neo-naturalists see an inborn sense of justice in law and disagree with the classical naturalists on unjust laws not being laws, arguing that such laws, even though legal, are not obligatory. We go to others like Lon Fuller, who defend secular and procedural morality of law and distinguish the aspiration, which is the ideal, from the duty, the rules for orderly society, and then lists the requirements for the inner morality of law to include public promulgation, understandability, not too often changed, and then being consistently administered. Contestations begin right there. How do we justify law as a tool of social ordering in post-colonial societies where formal law was introduced in a brutish, rogue, and disorderly manner and actually was not uniformly enforced? And what is the nature of law in heterogeneous and legally pluralistic societies that have social norms that regulate human conduct besides formal law? Which norms are actually outside Judeo-Christian norms, which are the basis of most introduced formal law norms? We have other religions such as Islam, African religions, we have local ethics, we have culture, social conventions, and morality. The third contestation is the concept of the overall deity. And whereas in our constitution, in the preamble, we talk about one country under God, that takes into account monotheistic religions. But then there may be people who subscribe to other than the monotheistic religions. And then the other question is, do customary law norms meet Fuller's criteria, given that they are flexible, dynamic, they are not written, and they are not publicly promulgated? Another concept I look at is the rule of law, which is a political ideal, highly revered. Everybody talks about the breakdown of the rule of law in Kenya, but the scope and meaning of this ideal is contested. When people talk about the rule of law, and I think Aristotle was the first one to talk about the rule of law, it's distinguished from the rule of men. And is used for organizing modern societies and laws, promoting liberties, order, predictability, restraining actor structures and institutions and individuals. So it is there where we find tenets like equality before the law, no arbitrary exercise of power, remedies for breach of law or unlawful interference with liberties. Positivists insist on strict procedural aspects of the rule of law, clarity, stability, generality. But moral philosophy adds substantive aspects to rule of law, which are justice, fairness, and morality. And the question is, do the religious customary law tenets recognized in our constitution and norms emanating from the semi-autonomous social fields meet the rule of law criteria? They are actually part of law, broadly speaking. They can be very strong, determine rights and duties, and actually determine one's belonging. They are also the basis for our local citizenship.